model of levels of consciousness given in the Abhidhamma. And to recap, there are four planes or levels of consciousness: the sense desire realm, the realm of form, the realm of the formless, and the unconditioned or nibbana. We spoke about the realm of form as being the state of mind of one in jhana, when samadhi has reached the state of completion or perfection. The mind is completely still, and there is a transcending of the sense basis. The mind is no longer relating primarily to the input from the senses, but is turned inwards. The still more refined state of mind is the plane of the formless. Rupa Bhumi. This is a level of consciousness that doesn't relate to the physical plane at all. There are beings that exist in this form are called mind only. They have, or four khanda, they have no bodies, they're just pure mind. Which is a difficult state of being for us to imagine, because we're so tied up and grounded in our physical form. Our body is an integral part of our existence at this level, so it's difficult for us to imagine not having a body at all. For example, the idea of location, being here or there, having a XYZ coordinate, is irrelevant to beings in the formless level. You can't say that they're here or there, or anywhere or nowhere, because space and location is a quality of the khanda of form, of matter, materiality. So without materiality, location makes no sense. Contemplating this level of existence is very tricky, but it's worthwhile to make the effort in order to gain some understanding of body and mind. Understand what is body, what is mind. Difficult because our ordinary experience as human beings at this level of existence is so tied up with the physical body and the physical senses, and it makes it difficult for us to understand what is mind. There's always a tendency for if we're not careful, there's a tendency when thinking about mind to make it into a kind of materiality. That should not be done. The qualities of matter, of having shape and mass and color and extension and all the rest, this does not apply to mind. So while there are beings that can exist in this state of mind only, it's also possible as a human being, an embodied human being, to have some experience of this level of consciousness in the four formless abidings. This is another set of meditative states that go beyond physicality. With the jhanas, we go beyond the senses. This takes us beyond physicality altogether and gives us an experience of the mind in its own nature. And there are four states or levels of this, beginning with the basic boundless space, then the basic boundless consciousness, then the base of nothingness, and finally the base of neither perception nor non-perception. The base of boundless space is the entry point, and it still has some remnant of connection to the physical world, because space is a quality of the physical world. But it's essentially the bridge. Space is quality of the physical world, but it's empty. It's, you know, by definition, it's purely empty. The Sarvastivadin school classified space as being unconditioned. The Theravada does not. Theravada view is that only Nibbana is unconditioned. The Theravadin theory of space is that space essentially doesn't exist except as a convention or an abstraction for locating objects. And it's conditioned only in the kind of space, for example, the hole in the ground when you dig a well, you've created a space. And that's conditioned because it's been dug. But space as a construct, as an abstract concept, is considered just a convention. Be that as it may, however we think of space, it's let's say the most ephemeral kind of connection to the material world. And in that base, there's only the mind filling infinite space. And then in the next base, there's only the mind. It's the base of infinite consciousness. We dispense with space altogether. And then when we cease paying attention even to consciousness, then there's nothing left. And this is no thingness. It's the Pali's akinchayatna. It's no thing. There's no thing present whatsoever. So the base of nothingness. And then even nothingness as a concept becomes too busy, and the mind transcends that and rests in a state called neither perception nor non-perception, which is kind of a obscure name, but the commentary gives a couple of examples to see what's meant by perception and non-perception. It depends on whether you can call it perception or not, depends on context. And it gives an analogy. It says that a monk and a novice are out walking for alms, and the novice sees there's a puddle of water ahead, and so he warns the monk to avoid it. He says, "Venerable sir, there's water." And the monk says, "Oh good, there's water. Fill my water jar for me." And the novices, Venerable Sir, there is no water. So this is a case of both water and non-water. and this is the and this is the perception or non-perception is that there's there isn't an ordinary kind of perception, but there is still, it isn't a complete annihilation, so there remains a kind of subtlety of perception. And the way to touch these states of mind is by a meditative subtraction. That if you, we continue that I spoke yesterday about the progress on the path as purification and simplification. So we're not adding anything anywhere along the way. We're simplifying our experience to get a more immediate, more basic or primordial state of mind, more natural state of mind as we go, by removing complexity. And these formless states are not something additional added to the mind, but they're how the mind expresses itself when it's stripped down to its basic functioning. So neither perception nor non-perception, the subtlest state of all, is the most minimalist, refined state that still could be classified as conditioned, is still samsaric. It's samsara at a bare minimum. Samsara without all the bells and whistles of the realm, form realm, and even more so of the sense desire realm. It's just immediate conditioned existence. And there's at least a couple of ways of accessing these states that are talked about in the suttas. One of them is to begin with ordinary mundane level consciousness and gradually strip away aspects by non-attention until all that's left is the formless. Another method is to begin with the Brahma Viharas extended to infinity of space, and then to make a transition from that to boundless space. So I would like to for us to do that together as a guided meditation. When, as we spoke about the Brahma Viharas yesterday, you should have some idea of it. And we'll go through metta meditation and then transition into looking at the formless states. So get yourself comfortable for the meditation position.